Welcome to Firebase Release Notes for January, where we cover recent big and small releases from Firebase. We're ramping up for a very exciting 2022 here at Firebase HQ. Well, we have five releases to cover today, so let's dig in right away. When you use Firebase in a native mobile or web application, you have to specify the configuration details that allow the app to connect to your Firebase project. Traditionally, this configuration data is stored in a googleservice.info.plist file for iOS, in a googleservices.json file for Android, and in a JavaScript code snippet for web apps. Well, if you build your web or mobile application using Flutter, you can now also specify all of your configuration data directly inside your Dart code, without having to add the configuration files to the native projects. This makes it much faster to get started, and is one of the many recent improvements to using Flutter and Firebase together. Another improvement comes when you use the real-time database in Flutter, specifically when you request the child nodes in a certain order. You used to have to use a child event listener for this, or use the Firebase List Helper class, as we've shown here. And while those approaches still work, in recent releases we added a children property to each data snapshot, so that you can loop as I've shown here. This brings the Flutter syntax on par with most of our SDKs for other platforms, so that's a good thing. See my Stack Overflow answer with code samples of all of these approaches that are linked below. If you've started a new Firebase project with Firestore or the real-time database in the past years, you know that the default security rules for testing provide open access for just a month. After that month, the rules deny all access from non-trusted clients, such as our SDKs for mobile and web apps. Now, you should modify the rules within the month to meet your application needs. But if you forget to do so, or if you abandon the project altogether, after a month, all data will be locked from further access to prevent accidental data leaks. Now, to reduce the number of files that are accidentally left unprotected, we're bringing the exact same default security rules to cloud storage for Firebase 2. Now, when you add a new bucket to your project and select test mode, the files will only be accessible for a month. If your access to the files or data is about to expire, we will alert you through emails and through the alerts console that you can get to by clicking the little bell button in the top right of the Firebase console. Over the holidays, many developers using the Firebase command line interface were surprised to see ASCII art in their terminal windows, like we see in this bug report. This problem was caused by a breaking change in a package that our CLI uses. And while the problem in the underlying package was quickly fixed, the Firebase CLI now pins versions of the packages that it depends on to prevent this from happening again. So upgrade to version 10.1 or later to get our CLI with pinned dependencies. With Google's virtual private cloud, your organization can define a parameter around the Google Cloud resources that it uses, so that they can only be accessed from networks and devices that you configure. This reduces the risk that bad actors can access these resources. Now, access to Firestore can also be controlled through the VPC service controls by providing additional configuration. This feature is still in preview at the moment, but already available to all users. So check out the link that I shared below to better control who can access your Firestore data and from where they can do that. Those were all the updates we have time for today. If you like this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel below. My name is Frank Rapuff, and I'll see you on a future episode of Firebase Release Notes.